Okay. Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we are actually looking at the output characteristics of a common base configuration, and in common base configuration, the base terminal is common for input and output signals. Okay, we are looking at the transistor here as a two-port network, you can say, and there are two ports here, the input port. Okay, this side is actually the input side. So we can consider this as the input port. So this is input port, input side, and output side. Okay, so input ports has two input parameter, the emitter current IE and the input voltage which is VEV, emitter based voltage, and the output side it is the output current IC and the output voltage VCV. So the output characteristics for this common base configuration is drawn between IC and VCV by taking this IE, the input current, as a parameter. Okay, so the IC, collector current, is drawn against the collector base voltage, where the variable parameter is IE. Okay, whenever you draw an output characteristics for any configuration, basically, so for output characteristics you actually draw it like this. It is drawn between the output current and the output voltage, where you take the input current as a variable parameter. So similarly, you can also draw for the common emitter configuration, okay, between the output current and the output voltage, taking the input side current as a parameter. Okay, so IC is drawn versus VCV, collector base voltage, and there is a large change in the VCV. You can see the collector base voltage is variation is from minus 5 volt to 20 volt. Okay, so it is going to capture a different operation mode, like the saturation mode as well as active mode, and the cutoff mode as well. Okay, so this is the cutoff mode, you can see. Alright, so first let us concentrate on the active mode. Okay, so in active mode, you can see the emitter base junction is in forward bias and collector base junction is in reverse bias. So this equation holds true, IC equal to alpha naught IE plus ICVO. Okay, and you can see that there is a weak dependency of ICVO over VCV. Okay, so we can consider, approximate that this IC is almost constant with VCV. Okay, it doesn't change much until the VCV is quite large. Okay, and in that case, with IE, IC will vary, and you also know that this alpha naught is close to 1. Okay, so IC will be very close to IE in the active mode of the operation. Okay, so here you can see the collector current at y-axis, this is IC, and in active mode of the operation the curves are flat. Okay, they are not changing much with the VCV, collector base voltage. So this region is quite useful for the amplifier design. Okay, if you wish to design a voltage amplifier or a current amplifier using the common base configuration, common base configured BJT, then actually you bias the transistor in the active region of the operation. Okay, and we already discussed why this VCB IC is not changing much with VCB. It is because that there will be a weak dependency of this ICBO over VCB. Okay, ideally it should change little bit. Okay, but since the magnitude of this ICBO is quite small, that is that can be neglected. Okay, so thus these characteristics. So for different, for example, for emitter current of 4 milliampere, the IC is almost 4 milliampere, the active region of the operation. Okay, so this is the active region, and in active region this formula will work. Okay, IC equal to alpha naught I plus ICBO. So this alpha naught is relevant in active region of the operation. Okay, and however, when we go into the saturation, so saturation region, as you can say, is shown here, okay, to the left of this dotted line. Okay, so this region is the saturation region, and this is for the negative value of VCB. Okay, so negative value of VCB indicates the forward biasing of the collector base junction. Okay, if it is VCB equal to -1 volt, so it indicates that the collector base junction is forward biased by 1 volt. Okay, so till if we follow this IC variation versus VCB, okay, I am reducing VCB, so the IC is constant. Okay, it's still constant. But at when VCB is equal to 0, still at this particular point, actually the collector current is constant. Collector current starts decreasing when the VCB becomes positive. Okay, so the region is actually explained here, you can see with the help of these two pictures. Okay, so in this first picture, the minority carrier concentration is shown in the base region for the different value of VCB. So in first case, the collector base voltage is 0. In the second case, VBC is greater than 0. It indicates that the collector base junction is in the reverse bias. So when the collector base junction is in reverse bias, the minority carrier concentration at this edge of the depletion region is 0. Okay, but when VBC is 0, then the minority carrier concentration at this particular junction will be equal to simply the this thermal equilibrium value of the minority carriers. Okay, so when VCB is VBC is greater than 0 in reverse bias, or even if there is a 0 bias here, you can say VBC equal to 0. So in that case, you will see that there is not much change in the slope of this curve. Okay, so if there is not much change in this slope of the minority carrier, so collector current will more or less remain constant. Okay, however, if there is a although there is a small change here seen, so this small change will lead to the change in may lead to the change in the collector current. Okay, but that is very small, so that is also neglected in this characteristic. Okay, however, when the collector base junction is in forward bias, so in that case, as we discussed in the previous class, that the majority carriers will be also injected from the collector into the base, and majority carriers are whole. Okay, so holes are being injected into the base region from both emitter side as well as from the collector side. So therefore, the minority carrier concentration here is actually much larger than the PNO value, okay, equilibrium value. Okay, and if the collector base junction also collector also injects the carrier in the same proportion as the emitter is injecting in the base region, then this curve becomes flat like this. Okay, and when this curve becomes flat, it means the current is 0. Okay, so by keeping this collector based voltage. Keeping this collector based junction is already in the forward bias. If I keep increasing this voltage, forward bias voltage, there may be a forward bias voltage at which this the base the collector region will start injecting almost comparable carrier to the what emitter is injecting into the base region. And in that case, you can see the minority carrier is same as at the both edges of the depletion region, and as a result, the collector current almost becomes zero. So that's why here you can see when the VCB is reduced below zero, it means the collector base junction is made forward biased. Then the collector current starts decreasing, and it collapses finally at the large forward bias potential of collector base voltage, maybe minus 2 volt in this case, okay, or minus 1 volt in this case. Okay, so when VCB is less than 0 and closer to, let's say, when it is when it goes below 0, the current starts decreasing, and current will eventually becomes 0 when the VCB becomes is close to negative value. Okay, and all the curves for the different values of IE will actually follow this. Okay, so the region to the left of this line is noted as the saturation region. Okay, in saturation region, the current will be actually smaller than the active region. Okay, however, at the verge of saturation region, at the onset of saturation region, you can consider the current is actually same as that of the active region current, okay, because this IC is constant with VCB. Okay, so this is saturation region, active region, and the another one is the cutoff region. So the cutoff region is one where when you make this IE equal to zero, then the base emitter junction is left open. Okay, I'm not keeping this in the reverse bias. I'm just keeping it even open, the base emitter junction. Okay, so in that case, the IC becomes equal to, because IE is taken as a zero, so IC becomes equal to ICBO. Okay, so if IC is below ICBO, then we consider the region to be cutoff region. Okay, so if VEB is open, or even if it is in mild reverse bias, okay, and also the collector base junction is in reverse bias, then the current will be very small, okay, maybe less than ICBO, and we'll note this region as the cutoff region. Okay, so this is cutoff region. So an analog circuits like amplifier will be to design that will use this region, whereas to design a digital circuit like inverter, we will use the saturation region as well as the cutoff region. We actually use the onset of saturation and the cutoff region. So one of the logic may be defined in this region, and the logic may be defined in this region. Okay, so one or zero may be defined in the saturation region and the cutoff regions. Okay, so this is the output characteristics of a common voltage common base configuration. Okay, any question, any doubt, if you have, please feel free to ask. Anybody?
The saturation region start from zero, right, and goes backward.
Yeah, you're right.
Okay.
It is for the negative values of VCB, means the collector base junction is just forward bias. Even in case of mild forward bias, there could be a significant current drop in the collector current. Significant current drop, significant output current drop may be seen. Okay. Is it clear? All right. So having discussed this common base configuration, we'll now talk about the common emitter configuration. Okay, and there again we will talk about the output characteristics. So the common emitter configuration, as you can see here, is shown with PNP transistor. And I will again remind you that whatever we are talking here in context of PNP transistor, similar analysis, parallel analysis can also be there for NPN transistor. So that you should also try to understand yourself. Okay. The only difference will be the bias voltages will be in the reverse, opposite, and also the current will flow in the opposite directions. Okay, so here the common emitter configuration is shown for a PNP transistor, you can see, this emitter region is grounded. Okay, this is common for both input and output. So because input is given between base and emitter and output is taken between collector and emitter, so that's why we call this configuration as a common emitter configuration. Okay, and in common emitter configuration, if you are concerned about the active region of active mode of the operation, then we can use this equation. Okay, and just like as I mentioned in the context of common base configuration, in common collector configuration too, the output characteristics will be drawn between IC and VCE, output current and output voltage. Okay, output current and output voltage, input current will be taken as a parameter. So in this case, the input current is the base current. So you can see that in this characteristics, IV characteristics, it is drawn between IC and VEC, okay, and IB is taken as a parameter, variable parameter. So this is actually plotted for the different IV value. Okay, so IB value is actually made constant. If you are willing to plot this characteristics, then we'll fix IB value by biasing this base emitter junction. Okay, so we can keep a battery here with a resistance, and in the base emitter loop the base current can be fixed. Okay, because and once the base current is fixed, then we can change the emitter collector voltage VEC, and we can plot IC. Okay, another battery source is required. Okay, that will provide this emitter collector voltage. We'll change this VEC and we can record this IC. Okay, so here is the characteristics. Okay, so first let us again concentrate on the active region of the operation. So in active region of the operation, we already discussed that this relation will hold true. Basically, this is the same relation for the common base configuration. Okay, because in common base configuration, the input current was the emitter current and output current was the collector current. But in common emitter configuration, the input current is a base current and output current is collector current. So that's why the relation between the collector current and the base current is actually established. Okay, and to establish that, we have used the same relation as it was used for the common base configuration. Okay. So what we see is IC equal to alpha naught IE plus ICBO. Okay, and IE is a sum of the base current and the collector current, as we have already discussed. Okay, so that can be substituted here, and then the IC terms can be kept together. So this IC goes to the left hand side, it becomes IC minus IC minus alpha naught IC to the left hand side, and in the right hand side it becomes alpha naught IB plus ICBO. Okay, then this is solved for IC and we get this relation, IC equal to alpha naught upon 1 minus alpha naught into IB plus ICBO upon 1 minus alpha naught. Okay, so alpha naught is a current gain, as you know. Okay, it's a it will relate collector current with the emitter current, but in this case we have to relate the collector current with the base current. Okay, so another parameter is defined, which is noted as the common emitter current gain. Okay, the common emitter current gain. Alpha naught was common base current gain. Okay, so the common emitter current gain is defined as a beta. Okay, and this beta is actually is defined as this beta naught equal to IC upon IB. Okay, or for AC signal, you can define it as a change in the collector current for the change in the base voltage. Okay, so this beta naught is defined as a alpha naught upon 1 minus alpha naught. Okay, and if we define it, then we can substitute this alpha naught upon 1 minus alpha naught by beta naught. Okay, so here we go. This alpha naught upon 1 minus alpha naught is actually taken as a beta naught here, and this ICBO upon 1 minus alpha naught, 1 minus 1 upon 1 minus alpha naught becomes 1 plus beta naught. Okay, and therefore IC becomes beta naught IB plus 1 plus beta naught ICBO. Okay, so IC becomes beta naught IB plus 1 plus beta naught ICBO. Okay, and ICBO, just like we defined ICBO for the common base case, okay, we can also define a similar term for the common emitter case. So in emitter case, basically the base terminal will be left open, base emitter loop will be left open to determine the leakage current. Okay, so a current is defined as a ICEO. So this ICEO is basically the collector current when the base emitter loop is kept open. Base terminal is a floating one. Okay, so base is replaced by O actually. So ICEO is basically ICBO divided by 1 minus alpha naught, or it is 1 plus beta naught into ICBO. You can use either of the equation. Okay, and therefore the total collector current is IC equal to beta naught IB plus ICEO. Okay, ICEO is related with ICBO. Okay, and a little bit more about this beta naught. Beta naught is related, beta naught depends upon alpha naught, and beta naught is as you see alpha naught upon 1 minus alpha naught. Okay, so if alpha naught is taken as a 0.999, the beta naught value could be 99. Okay, if alpha naught is slightly greater than this 0.9998, beta naught is much more larger than this value 99, it's 499. Okay, so we have we can get the transistors from the market that will have beta value varying from 50 to let's say 500. Okay, and we can design our circuit using those transistors. Okay, now the equations here, the collector current equation can be used to describe this output characteristics, at least in the active mode of the operation. So in the active mode of the operation, you can see IC with increasing IB, IC will increase. Okay, so as the IB is increased, you can see 50 microampere, 10 microampere, 15 microampere, 20 microampere. So IC curve are also shifting up. IC curve is shifting up. Okay, with increasing IB, the IC will also increase. And you can also sense here that there is a much more difference between IC and IB. That's why this beta naught is large. Okay, because IC, IB is in microampere range here, but IC is in milliampere range. Okay, it means that beta is large. So for a small base current, we can get a larger collector current, okay, in this configuration. And so it could also be used for the current amplification, because For a small change in the input base current, input current, we can get a large change in the output collector current. Okay, in the circuit, we can use this base current as a input current and collector current as a output current, and we can also realize the large current gain. Okay, in fact, this common emitter configuration is used in used for designing both high voltage gain as well as for the high current gain amplifiers. Okay, it provides both high voltage as well as high current gain. Okay, so in the active mode of the operation, you can see IC keeps going on with increasing IB. That is because here IC is proportional to IB, IC equal to beta naught IB. Okay, and IC is a function of ICEO, and it is also clear that this ICEO is going to be much larger than ICBO, because ICEO is ICBO upon 1 minus alpha naught. Okay, since alpha naught is 0.99, so 1 minus alpha naught, if 1 minus alpha naught is smaller, then ICO is going to be larger. And in fact, this ICO will be again, you can see here, if beta is 100, then ICBO is going to be 100 times larger than larger than ICBO. And that's why you can see that here the ICO is significant than what was the ICBO in the previous graph. Okay, the ICBO was very small here, but the ICO is large actually. Okay, because ICO is beta time 1 plus beta or beta time larger than ICBO. Okay. And then we can also explain why in this case the IC is increasing with VEC. Because IC is increasing with VEC, in this case it was almost flat. Okay, in this case the IC was not changing much with the output voltage VCB, but here the current is changing significantly with the output voltage VEC. Why it is so? It is again because of this CEO. So CEO is depends upon CBO. CBO will vary with VCB. Okay, so if you are increasing VEC, emitter collector voltage, keeping emitter voltage fixed, okay, base emitter voltage was kept constant, okay, then we are actually increasing VEC. So if you are increasing VEC, basically we are increasing VBC only, base collector voltage, because base emitter base voltage is constant. So if we will increase base collector voltage, this ICBO is going to increase. And as 1 plus beta, this ICEO is 1 plus beta time ICBO. So here the variation in ICBO with VCB gets amplified, and therefore this ICO becomes significant, change in ICO becomes significant. And that's why this curve here got a finite slope here. It is not flat unlike the previous case. Okay. So little bit change here in there in the current. This is also explained partially. There could be one more region. Okay, and we'll also explain that in the next slide. Okay, which is called the base width modulation effect or the early effect. Okay, so cutoff region is here the below ICEO. This is the cutoff region, and the cutoff region, if base current is zero, so the IC is actually, if base current is zero or smaller, the IC will be very small. Okay, and we'll call this region as a cutoff region. Okay, so this will be actually realized when the two junctions were in the reverse bias. Okay, and the saturation here is same as a, it was in the previous case. Okay, when the when we are actually decreasing VEC, okay, so there will be a value of VEC, If VEC is small, the chances is that the VCB goes forward bias. I mean, this collector base junction goes forward bias. Okay. And if you compare this with the previous characteristics here, so the saturation here comes for the negative value of VCB. Okay. But here actually it is for the positive value, even for a small positive value of VEC, we can observe this saturation region. So why does it happen? Can you guess it? In saturation, just like the previous configuration, the current will decrease, okay, and it will eventually become zero. All right. But unlike the negative VCB here, it is a positive VEC because the VEC is zero here. Why it is so? Anyone of you? Because in this case, even with positive VEC, the VCB has become, the collector base junction has become forward bias. Why it is so? Because VEC is VEB plus VBC, and this is kept constant to set up a base current. So this is a positive value. Okay. So if it is a positive value, let us say that 0.1 volt. Okay, and in this case, when VEC is 0, then VBC now has become negative. Minus by, let's say this is 0.4 volt. This has been already forward biased by 0.4 volt. If it was, VEC was equal to 0. Okay, even VEC is equal to 0, VBC, the base collector junction, is already forward biased by a certain amount. Okay. So even if VEC is equal to 0.4 volt in this case, if the emitter base junction is biased by 0.4 volt, or let us say that it is biased by most practical values you take, let's say it is biased by 0.6 volt. So when it is biased by 0.6 volt, so when VEC starts decreasing below 0.6 volt, the VBC becomes negative and this collector base junction becomes forward biased. And that's why you can see that there is no negative value of VEC shown in this curve. For the positive value of VEC, it is in the saturation region. So this is actually simplified for the circuit analysis. We just draw a line here. Okay. And let us say that this is 0.2 volt. Okay, it's an approximation. So we say that when VEC is 0.2, when the transistor is in saturation, the VEC is fixed at 0.2 volt. So VCE is 0.2 volt in saturation. When you will be analyzing the transistor based circuit, maybe in the first year two, you might have considered VCE equal to 0.2 volt to find out the maximum collector current. Okay. Because of this region only, because this characteristics is approximated, and we said that when the VCE is 0.2 volt, okay, the transistor is at the onset of saturation. This is the so-called approximated saturation region for a transistor. Okay, is it clear to all of you? Any question?
Sir, can you please explain it again why it is before positive only it is getting current is decreasing?
Okay. Any other question from anybody?
Sir, what does that zero represent in your breakdown thing?
Zero. Okay. That is actually base current.
Oh, okay, sir. Got okay. It.
This is emitter current or base current. In this case, it is base current 0, 5, 10, 15. In this one, it is the emitter current 0, 1, 2, 3 milliamperes. Okay. So the answer of your question is this actually. You just apply some KVL, okay? So VEB is this, okay? And VEC is this. So VEC is basically VEB plus VBC. VEC is VEB plus VBC. Am I right? And VEB is kept constant. Let us say that we are actually drawing, we have to draw this characteristic. So for this actually, I will have to make IB equal to 10 microampere. So to make IB 10 microampere, I will apply some VEB value. So let us say that that VEB value is 0.3 volt. Okay, so this is 0.3 volt. This is fixed. Okay, now I am reducing VEC down, okay, from higher value, okay, to see the saturation region. So it is plus equal to VBC. So at the moment this VEC goes below this 0.3 volt, the VBC has now become negative. Okay, and negative VBC means the forward bias to this junction. Because VBC means this is positive, this is negative, which is keeping this junction in the reverse bias. But at the moment, this VEC goes below this VEB value, the VBC becomes negative. Now it means that the P side is at positive potential than the N side. And therefore, this junction will again be turned on. And the saturation, it means these holes will also be started injecting from that side. Okay, so this emitter base junction is already injecting hole from P side to N side. Okay, so these are actually these two injections are in opposite direction and the current will decrease, as you can see here. If you start injecting carrier from this side, the flatness of this curve becomes more and more flat, which is the indication of less and less diffusion current. Okay, so if it is perfectly flat means the collector current is zero. Okay, that's what I was actually telling. Does it make sense?
Yes sir, got it.
Okay. So this is a common emitter configuration. This is common the output characteristics of common emitter configuration, and you might have noticed all those differences compared to that of the common base case. Okay, and similarly, you can go through your textbook and you can see how to draw the output characteristics for a common collector configuration. Okay, so in a common collector configuration, basically the output will be taken from the emitter. So it will be drawn between the emitter current, it will be emitter current between versus the collector emitter voltage. And the base current is a variable parameter. So that characteristics also becomes almost similar to that of common emitter characteristics, because the IE is very close to IC. Okay, so that's why I'm not discussing that. You can refer to the textbook. Okay, any book you can refer, Sedra Smith book. Okay, are microelectronics by the Sedra Smith. Or some other books, the characteristics you can see from there. Okay, is it okay? So this is the output characteristics, and this is very important to design the circuit using a transistor. Okay, but before we discuss the BJT as an amplifier, let us talk about little bit the slope of this curve here in the active mode of the operation. I told you that the ICO will be changing with VCE significantly. So that's why this curve has got some slope. Okay, and the another significant reason for this increment in the current against the emitter collector voltage VEC is the base width modulation effect. Okay, So base bit modulation effect can be explained in this particular fashion. Okay, so let's say that we have a PNP transistor here. So the emitter region, base region, and the collector region. Okay, collector base junction is in the reverse bias. So this is the biasing. Okay, so when I increase this collector base voltage, it can be increased directly or it can be increased in the common emitter mode. It can be increased by increasing the emitter collector voltage. Okay, so if I increase this, what will happen? The width here, the depletion width actually goes, you know that depletion region width increases with the reverse bias voltage, because this VCB is actually reverse biasing this collector base junction. Okay, if I keep increasing this VC, this keeps on increasing, so it goes on wider, it goes wider and wider. Okay, so when the depletion width going wider here, at the same time, if you look at the width of the base region, this will go narrower. Okay, because this was the total width. Okay, and now certain portion has become depleted. So actual base width have been now reduced. Okay, it's, let's say, becomes W effective, which is much smaller than W. Okay, and when you know that when base width effective base width will decrease, in that case what will happen, that the slope of this curve will keep on increasing. Okay, let me draw it. This is the edge of emitter base region depletion side, and this is the collector base side edge of the depletion region, and this is PN. Okay, so here it is PNX, PN naught. Okay, this is PNX. So when I keep this keep pushing this boundary in this direction, okay, so the new base width is going to be this, and if the base width is this, then this will actually decrease like this. Okay, I mean the slope of this minority carrier distribution is going to increase, and because of this increased slope, now the current has to be increased. So this increment, because of the narrowing the base width, is noted as base width modulation effect, or it is noted as also the early effect. Okay, and it will have mainly be responsible for the change in the collector current against the emitter collector voltage VEC. Okay, so this is because of the slope in this curve is because of the base width modulation effect. The ideal, the expectation is like this, that this curve would be a flat curves. Okay, because that would be required for a better circuit design. But because of this base width modulation effect, actually the IC will be changing with VEC. Okay, and if we extrapolate these curves, these will cut at this VEC axis at some particular point. All these curves will cut at this point. Okay, and this voltage VA is noted as the early voltage. Okay, and this is the indication that the slope in the ICVCE curve is an indication that there is a finite output resistance in the transistor. Okay, we will come to that, and when we will discuss the circuit model, okay, I will just refer back to this, and I will show you why this slope, how this slope is actually incorporated in the circuit model of bipolar junction transistor. Okay, so this is called the early effect or base width modulation effect. I think it is clear to all of you, because you already understand the basic concept behind this base width modulation effect. Okay, is it clear to all of you? Okay, so I think I should go ahead. And here actually it is time to describe the BJT as an amplifier. Okay, I have already told you many times that the BJT can be act as an amplifier or as a switch. Okay, so it's a basically a qualitative description why how the BJT can be used as an amplifier. Okay, so the BJT here is actually, you can see, kept in the common emitter configuration. Okay, with the input voltage applied between the emitter base terminal, okay, along with the bias voltage. Okay, so this VEB is a DC voltage. This is a DC signal. This is the AC input signal, which is to be amplified. Okay, and this is again VCC, which is a DC voltage that is keeping the collector base junction in the reverse bias. This VCB. Okay, in fact, this would be the smaller line. Okay, because this side will be positive, this side should be negative. Okay, so we would like to see if there is a change in the input voltage, because this VEB is to keep this emitter base junction in the forward bias so that a DC collector current will flow. Okay, DC collector current of the requisite value will flow. Okay, and then if there is a change in the input voltage here, because this is AC signal, AC signal is will be keep on changing with respect to time. Okay, so this is, let's say, our XT, the input signal that is to be amplified. So this will keep on changing with the time. So if this will keep on changing with the time, the VEV value will also change with respect to time. And as a result, you can see that if VEB will keep on changing, all the current will fluctuate against their average value, or you can say against the DC value. The DC value when there was this input signal was not connected. Okay, let us say that this AC signal, input signal, was not connected initially. Only there was VEB and there is VCC. So there was a DC IB, okay, and then there was a DC IE, and then there was a DC IC. But now, because of this VEB, is getting added with this VEB. Okay, this is AC signal. So let us represent the AC signal by this symbol, small v and a small subscript VVE. So when this is getting added with this DC signal VEB, the bias voltage, the actual base emitter voltage for this transistor, it will also keep on changing with respect to time, because this VVE is changing with respect to time. So therefore, all the current IC, okay, the total collector current IC, the total base current IB, and the total emitter current IE, all will be changing with respect to time. Okay, and these value will be changing with respect to their DC value, okay, when there was no AC input signal given. So we have to find out, to amplify the signal. Okay, if there is a fluctuating input signal here, and if this circuit is able to generate a larger fluctuation at the output side, okay, across this resistor, compared to the fluctuation at the input side, it means that this circuit can amplify the signal. Am I right? So here the objective is to show you qualitatively how a small change in the input voltage will lead to a large change in the output voltage across this resistor RL. Okay, so for a small change in the input voltage, if there is a large change in the output voltage, we can say that this signal is amplified. Although the power that was required to amplify that signal is actually supplied by these batteries. Okay, but in fact, the amplitude of this signal has been amplified. And this signal was, let us say, was not useful for certain application because of smaller amplitude, but this could be because its amplitude is large. So the many other circuits can sense this signal, which cannot sense this signal. So this process is useful. If we are able to raise the level of a signal, it's always good. Okay. So here with this output characteristics, it can be shown that how this input side signal can be amplified. Okay. So this is basically the output characteristics IC versus VCE, okay, VEC. Okay, so we can take a break of 10 minutes and then we'll continue. Is it okay? Students?
Okay, sir.
It has been already almost 1 hour, so let us take a break of 10 minutes and we'll meet at again 6:05. Okay. So before we discuss the working of BJT as an amplifier, I would like to ask you one question. Do you understand what is the operating point or Q point in a transistor? Students, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you might have studied this in your basic electronic course. Electrical sciences, I think. Do you know what is operating point or Q point? No. Anyone of you? Okay, so let me give you a brief idea on the operating point. Okay, so at a common emitter configuration, okay, this description is actually discussion is applicable for all configuration. Or all other configurations as well. Okay. So for a common BJT under common emitter configuration, we discuss its output characteristics. Okay, it was like this: IC versus VCE. Okay, it was drawn for the different values of IB, and the curve was like this. Okay. Okay, so the curve was like this. So here actually the VCE was varied, and therefore we get the different values of IC. But in a circuit, when you bias this transistor, okay, what you are going to do, you are going to apply a fixed emitter based voltage VEB, okay, and there will be a fixed VCC, and then this resistor RL will be connected here to control the current. Okay, so because the VEB, which is and the VCC, and because of or you can call it, let us say VEC, so this VEB and VEC both are constant, fixed. Okay, it means that there will be constant, there is a fixed value of the base current IB and the fixed value of emitter current and the fixed value of the collector current, that you can notice at the different terminals of the transistor. Okay, so this combination of this IC and VEC in this case for the common emitter configuration is actually noted as the Q point or the operating point of the transistor. Okay, because of this VEB, alright, this must be VCC and this is actually VEC. VEC will be different because there may be some drop in this resistor RL, and therefore this VEC is not exactly same as VCC because this RL. In the previous circuit, we didn't consider RL, so we are taking VCC as a VEC. But in this case, VEC will be this. Okay, so for the given VEB, VCC and the and this resistance value RL, we'll get a constant value of the collector current and the fixed value of collector current and the emitter current, emitter collector voltage. Okay, so this is actually noted as the Q point or the operating point. And how do we get that? By the DC analysis of the circuit. Okay, you might have studied the different biasing schemes of BJT. There you might have computed these parameters IC, IB, and IE, VBE, VC, and so on. Okay, so in this case, however, we can use few equations because we already know the equations in the active mode of the operation. Considering the transistor is in the active mode of the operation, see, so we know the current relations in the active mode of the operation, and we can also use this KVL expression VCC minus this ICRL is equal to VEC. Okay, and with the help of these two equations, we can determine the collector current IC and the emitter collector voltage VEC. Okay, so but please note that all this analysis is carried out by neglecting the AC signal, which is to be amplified by this amplifier. Okay, so first we remove the AC signal, then we carry out its DC analysis, and we determine its operating point. We'll get the IC and VCE value, because this is the output characteristics. This we get by varying VCE, IB, and IC. But in a real circuit, in an amplifier circuit, when there is no AC signal connected, then the VEB will be fixed, VCC will be fixed, IC, IB, IE, all are fixed. Okay, and therefore the collector current IC and this VEC, in this case, common emitter case, is noted as the operating point or the Q point for the transistor. Now, if I apply an AC signal here, let's say a sinusoidal signal is, small sinusoidal signal is applied along with this VEB. So this will now create a disturbance. Because of this, now the IB will fluctuate. So IB, the base current will now fluctuate over this quiescent value of the base current. So let us say that earlier, this was base current IB, DC value. So now because of this VEB variation, there will be variation over this AC component will be superimposed on the DC component of the base current, collector current, as well as the emitter current. So without AC input signal, the collector current was constant like here, AC, IC. But now when the VEB is considered, it will be fluctuating like this. Okay, along this, I mean, an AC component is actually superimposed on the DC value of the collector current. Okay, so this is the quiescent point, actually operating point, and we need to keep this operating point at a proper place. Okay, so that we can get maybe the maximum gain, okay, or maximum linearity in the amplifier. For example, if I'm looking for a amplifier amplification of the signal, okay, and I will, let us say, the set the Q point here, okay. So this Q point here will actually restrict the variation in VCE, because there may be a positive change, large positive change in the VCE, but the negative change in the VCE will be truncated, okay. And you see that the change in VEC will also be this change in this potential across this output resistor will also follow this VEC, and therefore the output signal will be truncated. So what we will do, we will set the Q point at such a place that I get a maximum swing in the parameters, so that I can get a maximum swing in the output signal here, okay. So that's why the operating point is important, and the proper in the design, actually you have to set this Q point properly in order to get a good amplifier circuit, because you don't want, if you want to amplify an AC signal like this, you would like to have an amplified output signal like this. You won't like to have an amplified signal like this, okay. Means in this case the negative portion has been truncated, okay, it has been removed, only the positive portion is there. The actual signal had both positive and negative, so the amplified version of this must also have positive and negative as well. Only its shape must retain, okay, only the amplitude has to be increase or decrease. If an amplifier changes the shape of the signal, it means the amplifier is a bad one, okay. It has to preserve the shape of the input signal. Output signal shape must be same as that of the input signal, and for that actually the amplifier need to be linear, and also it should be able to provide the maximum swing of the signal at the across the load, okay. And that's why this selection of the Q point is very important. You first draw the ICVC characteristics of the transistor. You understand where is the saturation region, where is the cutoff region, okay, and this is our active region. So I must keep the Q point at this particular point so that I will be getting the maximum change in the collector current, maximum change in the base current, maximum change in the collector emitter voltage, so that I can get the maximum change in the output signal. I can avoid any distortion in the output signal if it is there, okay. So this is actually the operating point, and that's why it is important for any amplifier design, okay. Is it understood by all of you? Any question, in doubt? Okay. So am I audible to you or not? Yeah, okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
So now with this background of the operating point, the quotient point of the transistor, now we can have this discussion about the transistor as an amplifier, okay, which is shown using the output characteristics. Sorry. Okay. I have to share the screen now. Okay. Am I audible now? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here the amplification is actually shown. You see that the AC input is connected between the emitter and base terminal along with the DC signal which is going to bias this transistor, which is going to set the get a proper operating point. So this is for the getting a proper operating point. Operating point, okay. And these two will ensure the proper operating point here. Operating point means, as I said, the value of IC and VEC. So in this case, the coordinate of this corresponds to this value of IC and this value of VEC. Okay, and how do we get it? Basically, we can use the transistor characteristics, and apart from this, we can also write a KVL in this loop, okay, which is basically VCC equal to VEC plus ICRL, okay, and from here I can write that IC is minus 1 upon RL VCC minus VEC. So the load line is basically the equation of this line, which actually relates the collector current with the output current with the output voltage, okay, using the KVL in the output loop, okay. And the slope of this line will actually depends upon this 1 upon RL, okay. So the at the point where this line will intersect with the IV characteristics, that will be quiescent point, okay. So the IV value that was established in this circuit with the help of this VEB was this actually, okay. So therefore this intersection point is the operating point, okay. So if there is no AC signal present here, no AC input, then the collector current is IC, output voltage is VEC, and the base current is IB. Okay, now because of now when this VEB is considered, and let us say that it's an AC signal fluctuating, okay, so this VEB results in the varying base current IB, and the IB, because IB is the current because of this PN junction, okay. So IB depends upon VEB. If there is a change in VEB, IB will change exponentially, okay. So because of this AC signal here, you can see the VBE is IB is actually changing around its quiescent value. So this is the quiescent value. Let us say here IB does 10 milliampere, here 15 milliampere. Let us say IB is 11 milliampere here. Okay, so around the 11 milliampere there is a fluctuation, and this fluctuation is because of this signal, okay. So if there is a change in IB, so from this characteristics we know that there will be corresponding change in IC. So here you can see the IC and the peak value of IC, and this is the peak value of IB, and you can see that there is a few microampere 11 microampere. So for a few microampere change, okay, in the base current there is a significant change in the collector current of in milliampere range. Collector current is changing from 2 milliampere to 6 milliampere. So there is a change of 4 milliampere here, okay, and here the change is, let us say, 15 microampere here and 10, and then this is slightly greater than 5, so let us say 6, so 6, 5, 9 microampere change in the base current is leading to 10 milliampere change in the collector current, and this current is actually passing through this resistor. So when there will be change in 10 milliampere here, so that, and let us say that this resistance is in few kilo ohm, so that few milliampere change in the collector current will lead to the few volt change in the output voltage here, okay. So thus actually you can see the signal is amplified. Here the input voltage may be change in the input voltage may be very small, 0.1 let us say of the order of 0.1 volt, okay. here you may find a change of the 1 volt, okay, greater than, let us say, 1 volt, okay. So thus this amplification process, you can observe this amplification, how this circuit is able to amplify a signal, okay. Is it okay? So a transistor can amplify. Now it has been established. Okay. Any question? Any doubt from anybody? So transistor is a linear device or non-linear device? What do you say? Do you consider transistor as a linear or non-linear device?
Sir, in general it is non-linear.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you're right.
In general it is non-linear.
But why it is non-linear?
Sir, because it doesn't follow the Ohm's law. That means the voltage and current is not proportional.
Right. Because its voltage and currents are actually exponentially related, okay, and exponential function is a nonlinear function, so that's why it's a nonlinear device, okay. But if you use those equations to solve the circuits to analyze the amplifiers, it gets complicated, okay. So what is done, a linear model of these nonlinear devices are developed, okay. And how we can develop a linear model, we will have an assumption. The assumption is about the amplitude of the input signal. We say that the input signal amplitude is so small, it's very very small, okay. The signal means the AC signal that has to be amplified. So if the AC signal amplitude is very small, then we can actually linearize the terminal relations, okay. We can have a linear relation between the current and the voltage, alright. So the circuit models are basically small signal models. We call it a small signal because these models are for a small change in the input signal, okay. And for that small change in the input signal, the transistor, the non-linear transistor, can be approximated as a linear device, okay. So we developed the small signal linear models for these transistor and based on those small signal linear model, we actually analyze the amplifier circuits, okay. So we'll start with the hybrid parameter based hybrid parameter model, which is also called H parameter model of the BJT. Okay, so I think you are familiar with the two port network. Am I right? Are you familiar with the Z parameter, Y parameter, H parameter? All of you? Anyone of you? No, okay. Even if you're not familiar, there is no problem. Okay, I will explain a little bit and then we'll proceed. So, you see, a circuit may be a complicated one. Circuit, I hope you already know. You might have studied. You may have studied different kind of circuits. Okay, amplifiers, rectifiers. Okay, so circuit may have a different component inside, okay, but if we know its input current and voltage, okay, and their relations, then we'll be able to know what is the inside this circuit. The behavior of this circuit may be understood with the help of terminal currents and the voltage relations, okay. And a two port network is like this, where you see that at least two terminals are coming out as an input terminal and the two terminals are going out as the output terminal. So between these two input terminals, when we apply an excitation V1, if we give a signal V1, okay, then we will here get a output V2, okay, voltage, it's basically output voltage between the two terminals, and there will be a current associated as well with this terminal, because if you connect a load here, basically the same current will pass through this terminal and this terminal. So that's why current I2 and voltage V2 are associated with the two output terminals, and the input V1 and the current I1 are associated with the two input terminals. Okay.
So sir, I2 and V2 are output, right?
These are related with the output terminals. For example,
so how?
For example, in this common emitter configuration, you see that the collector and emitter were acting as a output terminals, okay, and the base and emitter were acting as a input terminals, okay. So this is actually we are not sure that what will be the actual direction of the current, but these are reference directions, okay, for the current. Let us say that I1 is entering and I2 is also entering into the network. These are reference directions. Okay. So we have terminal relations, like we can write it like this. The V1, the input voltage, could be written as a H11 into I1 plus H12 into V2. Okay, and similarly the I2, the output current, could be written as a H21I1 plus H22V2. Means the input voltage and the output currents are related in terms of input current and the output voltage. Okay, so similarly you'll see that the input voltage V1, okay, and the output input voltage V1 and the output voltage V2 can be written in terms of input current I1 and the output current I2. Okay, so that are actually the Z parameters. Similarly, if the two currents are represented in terms of the two voltages, means I1 here and V1, V2 here to the right hand side, and similarly I2 here and V1 and V2 here, we call it Y parameter. We get the admittance. Okay, but this is hybrid, because at the input side we are taking voltage and output side we are taking current, and the input voltage and the output current are actually written here in terms of input current and the output voltage. That's why it is called the hybrid model of the circuit. Okay, getting it? I could write it V1, V2 and V1 as a function of F1, I1, I2, okay, or V2 as a function of I1, I2. So this will be Z parameter. Or I can write I1, I2 as a function of V1, V2, or as a function of V1, V2. I will call it Y parameter. Here I will get impedance, here I will get admittance, but this is hybrid, because input side we take voltage, output side we take current. Okay, and what are these H11, H12, H21 that are actually defined here? H11 is basically V1 upon I1 when the V2 equal to 0. So to get H11, what I have to do? I have to keep this V2 0. If V2 is 0, okay, then this term will vanish. And I will get H11 as a V1 upon I1. Okay, so that's why here you see H11 is defined as a V1 upon I1 when V2 is 0. It means when I have to determine the H11 for a circuit, I will sort the output terminals. I will sort it. When I will sort it, the V2 goes 0. And then I will apply a certain voltage here between the input terminal V1, and I will measure this current I1. and I will take the ratio of these two, V1 upon I1, and I will call it as a H11. Okay, V1 upon I1, I will call it as a H11. Okay. Similarly, regarding H12 is, so basically what will be the unit of this H11? It's basically resistance. Okay, the V1 upon I1, it's basically input resistance, you can see, for this two port network, because it is V1 upon I1, the input voltage divided by the input current when the output side is shorted. V2 is 0. And similarly, H12 can be defined here. H12 is, if I will keep I1 equal to 0, then this term will vanish. And then I can define H12 as a V1 upon V2. So H12 is V1 upon V2, but I will have to keep I1 equal to 0. And how do I get I1 equal to 0?
Break the circuit.
Yes, I will keep the input port open. Okay, nothing will be connected here. All right, so that will be H12. And H12, if you look carefully, this is input voltage divided by the output voltage. So it's a actually reverse voltage gain. Okay. Generally, we define voltage gain as a output voltage divided by the input voltage. But here we are writing it as a input voltage divided by the output voltage. So it's a kind of reverse voltage gain. But to determine it, we have to make sure that the input port is open. Okay. No input current is flowing. All right. Similarly, the H21 is I2 upon I1, and I need to keep V2 0. So by keeping V2 0, I can define H21. H21 is I2 upon I1 by taking V2 equal to 0. Okay. So this is actually, you see, is a current gain. Is it or not? It is the ratio of the output current divided by the input current, provided V2 equal to 0, means I will have to sort this, then only this I2 will flow. Okay, so I2 divided by I1 at V2 equal to 0 is H21, and it's a current gain, output current divided by the input current. Okay, and what is H22? H22 is I2 upon V2. H22 is I2 upon V2 when I1 equal to 0. So input left open, input port is left open, and then a voltage source is connected here, V2. This current is measured, and this is the ratio of this V2 upon I2. Okay, so what is the unit of this H22? It's a conductance. Okay, it's the inverse of the resistance. All right, V2 upon I2 would be output resistance. So you can call it 1 upon output resistance, RO, because it is I2 upon V2. It's a conductance. H22 is the conductance. So for any two port network, if you know these parameters, if you measure these parameters, H11, H12, H21, H22, so you can develop a circuit model for that. Okay. So you see, these two equations are actually realized here using some passive components. Okay, and active components as well. So all are actually passive, voltage source and current source and the passive elements. So H11, as you can see here, is V1 upon I1. So it's a resistance, input resistance. So that's why it is shown as a box here. It's a resistance actually. And V1 is H11 I1 plus H12 V2. So H12 V2. It's a H12 into V2. H12 is the reverse voltage gain multiplied by the output voltage. So it is the input voltage. Okay. So it's a voltage source actually. You can see it as a voltage dependent voltage source, because the output of this voltage source depends upon the output of this voltage source depends upon V2. So it's a dependent voltage source. Okay, so this is the voltage related with the input side, but it depends upon the output voltage. So that's why a diamond shape is taken here, which is an indication of a dependent source. Okay, so H1 to V2 is a voltage dependent source. All right, similarly for the output side, I2 is H21 I1. So H21 I1 is basically it's a total, in totality it is a current, and the current is related with the output side. So output current is some factor multiplied by the input current. Okay, so that's why it can be modeled as a current source. So that's why here I have a current source H21 I1, which is again a dependent source, because this output current depends upon this input current. Okay, so this current is not directly related with this branch, so therefore it must be a dependent source. Okay, so H21 I1, and H22 is a conductance, one inverse of the resistance, so therefore a box is actually connected here. Alright, so if you have a transistor, you don't know what is inside the transistor. Okay, so by the experiment, if you could measure these parameters H11, H12, H21 and H22, then you will be able to develop a circuit model for the transistor. The circuit model is basically, it is relating the terminal currents with the different voltages. Okay, and so here you can see V1 related with I1, V2 related with the I2, I2 and H22 and the other parameters like input current. Okay, so as a transistor can be seen as a two-port network, so we can also develop its H parameter. But here the H parameter that we are going to develop for the transistor, under assumption that the voltages are very small in amplitude, okay, less than the thermal voltage. Alright, so if we consider this NPN transistor, now I am taking a NPN transistor, so that's why the current directions are changed little bit, you can see. Okay, the base current is going inward, collector current is going inward, and the emitter current will be coming outward. Okay, and the base emitter voltage should be positive in this case on the active mode of the operation, and this collector current VCC, collector voltage VCC should be larger. Okay, so we are going to develop a small signal model for H parameter model for this transistor, for this circuit actually. So input voltage in this case is VBE, input current is IB, output voltage is VCE, and output current is IC. Okay, so V1 here can be replaced by VBE, I1 here can be replaced by IB, V2 can be replaced by VCE, and I2 can be replaced by IC. And we can write the relations, okay, for these parameters in terms of H parameters. Okay, so here is that relation. So VBE is basically HIE into IB plus HRE into VCE. This is H11, this is H12. Okay, and similarly IC, and this is your V1. Okay, this is I1. This is I2, this is V2, this is H21, this is H22, I1 and I2. Okay, no confusion at this point. HI is H11, so input resistance, it will be VBE upon IB. HRE is the reverse voltage gain, that is the input voltage divided by output voltage, VBE upon VCE. HFE is the forward current gain, which is I2 upon I1. Okay, I2 is IC and I1 is IB, and the HOE is basically H22, its output admittance. Okay, which is actually IC upon VCE, IC upon VCE, and this is for IB equal to 0. Okay, So these are actually defined in line with the original definition of the H parameters, okay? And for a given transistor, you can actually measure this in one of the experiment you will be doing this, okay? So here the same model, H parameter model of the transistor is actually H parameter of the two port network is modified here, and we have this H parameter hybrid parameters for the BJT. So this being H11, this is H12, and this is H21, and this is related with H22. Okay, so H12 is HRE, H11 is HIE, H21 is HFE, and H22 is HOE. Okay, so HIE is basically VBE upon IB. So this is a input resistance seen into the base terminal of a common emitter configuration. Okay, and this HFE is basically IC upon IB. What is IC upon IB? We have already discussed about this. In common emitter case, what is IC upon IB? IC upon IB is beta. So HFE is nothing but it's a beta. It's a H parameter equivalent representation of beta current gain. That is HFE. Okay, so this is HFE. And HOE is basically 1 upon RO, the output resistance, inverse of the output resistance. This is the input resistance. This is the reverse voltage gain. Okay. Now, the measured value of these H parameters are shown for a typical transistor at IC equal to 1 milliampere. These measurements are done. Okay. So, what do we find? That the input impedance HIE is 1 kilo ohm. HRE is 3 into 10 to the power minus 4, which is very small. HFE is 250, which is actually nothing but equal to beta. And HOE is 3 into 10 to the power minus 6, which is also very small. Okay, so if you look in this circuit, what is the role of HRE? To set this potential value, and this potential in fact depends upon the output potential VCE. But since this HRE is very small, HRE into VCE is going to be very, very small. It can be neglected. And if we can neglect it, it means that we can replace this by a short circuited element. Okay. So the input side, we can have only this HIE. Okay, this is the transistor part. On the input side, we can have this HIE only. This is HIE. This can be neglected because HRE value is small. Similarly, in the output side, we have this HFE, which is 250. So it's a significant value, current gain. So this part will be there, HFE into IB. Okay. But 1 upon HOE, HOE is very small. So if HOE is very small, 1 upon HOE is going to be very, very large. So the resistance here between collector and emitter terminal is very large. And therefore, this 1 upon HOE can be neglected. A large output resistance indicates that the collector current remains constant. Okay. If its characteristics is like this, it is basically delta IC, 1 upon delta IC upon VCB in this case. But in this case, it will be delta IC upon delta VEC. Okay, it will the change in the collector current against the change in this emitter current voltage will actually give us R0. If these curves were flat, it means that R0 is 0 or the HOE is infinite. Okay, so R0 is 1 upon HOE. So a flat means, flat curve means very small HOE and therefore very large R0. It means that the early effect is absent in the device. Okay, but a finite value of finite slope in the output curve will lead to a finite value in HOE, and therefore the R naught is going to be finite. And in that case, the R naught has to be included in the circuit. Okay. So in this case, you can see the both R naught and HIE has been removed from the circuit. Okay, and this H parameter model of the transistor is actually used to get the voltage gain of this common emitter amplifier. This common emitter amplifier circuit, okay, and biasing resistors RB1, RB2, potential divider network to set a base emitter voltage, RE emitter resistance, RC collector resistance, okay. These are coupling capacitors, this is a bypass capacitor. So input signal will be given here, output will be taken from here. So first you will carry out the DC analysis, you will get its IC value and VEC value, okay. Or for the transistor, if the H parameters are known, then we can build up a H parameter circuit model. And then this H parameter circuit model will be placed here. Okay, this is, you can see, H parameter circuit model of the transistor. The R1 and R2, when you do the AC analysis, we remove the voltage source and we just sorted it to the ground. So this terminal will be grounded. Okay, this is also grounded. So this RB1 and RB2 comes in parallel. So that's why you see here RB1, RB2 are connected in parallel. Okay. This is our base terminal. So base terminal has is this terminal. So with this base terminal, the HIE is there. So with the base terminal and between the emitter terminal, so you will see this HIE. Okay, because the emitter terminal is grounded, and also this bypass capacitor will nullify the effect of this resistance. So this point is virtually considered to be ground. Okay, so that's why this emitter is grounded here. If the emitter, if this resistor was not bypassed by this capacitor, it would also be considered in the circuit. Okay, and on the output side, since this is connected to ground, so this is RC, and this will come in parallel with this HFE-IB, because HFE-IB is between collector and emitter. So between the collector and emitter, we have HFE IB, R naught is neglected, and this is all at all place. These are actually emitter points, okay, in the circuit. Okay, is it clear? Any question from anybody? Any doubt? Okay, so I think that I should close it now, because there has been a lot of discussion. Okay, you just revise what has been discussed so far on the BJT, and then we'll continue this. So you will be able to ask some questions as well. However, if you have any question, you can feel free to ask at this moment too.
Sir, can you please explain again why that HOE was not considered in circuit?
Okay. The reason is this HOE is very small. Okay, so if you take the 1 upon HOE, first you look what is HOE. HOE is IC upon VCE. So it's the inverse of the output resistance. Okay, output current divided by the output voltage. Okay, so if the HOE is very small, it means the output resistance is very large. Okay, if this resistance is very large, either it is coming connected in parallel with this HFE-IB, if this resistance is very large, it is not going to draw any current. Will it?
No, sir, it will not.
It will not. So if it is not drawing the current, I can remove it. Getting it? It's an indication that your IC VC characteristics is flat. It's not depending upon the output voltage. If this HOE is finite and RO is finite, it means that IC will depends upon VCE. It is just to this is incorporated to include the slope in the output current actually. If IC VCE characteristics you have seen here, okay, so there is a finite slope here, and this slope is actually so it means that this IC is a function of VEC. From this slope you can see that IC is a function of VEC. So with change in VEC, if IC is changing, it means there is a slope in the curve here. If with change in VEC there is no change in IC, means the curve will remain flat. Okay, so if HOE is finite, okay, so RO is also finite, so IC will depend upon this VC as well, because in that case IC will be what? IC will be HFE-IB plus VCE upon RO. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if I have to write the expression for IC, it is actually HFE-IB, okay, plus VCE into HOE, VCE into HOE. Here you see H22, it is IC is VCE into HOE, okay, so it's a VCE into HOE. So if this HOE is finite, it means IC depends upon VCE too, and this is actually capturing the effect of this slope in IC in the active region, okay. So this, and if this is a flat, IC is flat with VCE, no change in IC with VCE, then we can consider the R0, output resistance is very high. So this is open and IC is only equal to HFE-IB. It's not changing with VCE. So that's why actually in a practical case, if the output resistance is very large, okay, even in common emitter configuration, you can drop this. Okay.
Yes, sir, got it.
Any other question from anybody?
Sir, also, can you please share this recording so that we can revise?
Okay. So first, let me close this.